Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum everyone, and especially all of you watching online. I know there's been a lot of interest in tonight's programme. Before we proceed with our evening our question and answer session with our esteemed colleague here, Roshan Muhammad Salih, about his documentary, the hashtag of which is Spying for Muslims, I just wanted to talk a little bit about a couple of items. Obviously, we're here at the Islamic Human Rights Commission in the Islamic Human Rights Commission bookshop. We have an amazing selection of literature here, particularly on the topic that we're going to talk about tonight. And for those of you watching, whether you're in the UK or anywhere else in the world, you can go to our website, www.ihrc.org.uk. You can download quite a lot of these reports and so on for free, this one in particular. Although a few years old, is in fact still very good, well-used reference regarding the situation in the United Kingdom, but it's one that actually is being replicated all over the world and has some precedence elsewhere. So it's, if you're interested, this is a good introduction into it. We also have our online shop, which has many publications on this and many other human rights and Islam-related topics, and that's shop.ihrc.org. If you have a question and you want to interact with us this evening from outside of this premises, then please tweet us at IHRC, or you can post a question on our Facebook page, which is simply Islamic Human Rights Commission, or you can email us, media@ihrc.org. If you are tweeting, the hashtag is #spyingonMuslims. Without further ado, I'll introduce Roshan to those few people who may not know who he is. Roshan has been a journalist for 15 years. He started his career in local newspapers before moving into TV journalism with London Weekend Television, which gives away your age a little bit.
Yeah, 39.
Okay. He then went to work at Al Jazeera's English news website in Doha. On coming back to the United Kingdom, he became head of news at the Islam Channel between 2005 and 2007. He then moved on to Press TV, where he was head of news for 5 years in London. He's now an independent documentary maker. During Roshan's career, he's reported from over 25 countries. The sort of highlights, if you like, of include the Iraq war and occupation, the tragic Pakistan earthquake in 2006, the Lebanon-Israel war of the same year, the Iranian nuclear crisis, the Egyptian revolution, the Libyan revolution, the World Cup, the Olympics, and much more. So Roshan will talk a little bit for a few minutes, and then we'll open up for questions.
No, that is true, by the way. You actually believe the spiel that I sent you. Okay, I actually did prepare quite a long speech, but I don't think I'll do it anymore because I'll wait for the Q&A section, but I'll just briefly summarise what I was going to say. I mean, basically, I got interested in this topic when I met the Faruqi family about a year ago. And two things struck me. One was the fact the use of converts to fool them and to infiltrate them. As a Muslim, I just found that quite offensive. That, I think Haris Faruqi described it as a crime against God. And I just think that Muslims, it's an evangelical religion. We love it when people convert to Islam. So to actually be suspicious of converts, which I think Muslims are at the moment, that in itself is tragic. And I also felt that... I don't want to cast aspersions on converts, but if someone converts to Islam and is hanging around the mosque and is more interested in talking about jihad than spirituality, I think alarm bells should be ringing in your head. As a first step, of course, they'll be interested in politics at a later stage, but the conversion shouldn't be about politics. It should be about believing in Allah and the Prophet and the Quran. The second issue was the issue of entrapment. I found this very disturbing. I think if you look at the FBI, I mean, we haven't got a complete picture about what MI5 is doing. We have a much clearer picture of what the FBI is doing, and the security services tend to model after each other. And the FBI has used this entrapment techniques for many, many years, where literally they target individuals who they think might be terrorists on very flimsy evidence, maybe something they've said on Facebook. And then they're the ones that put ideas into their heads and even supply the bombs and supply the weapons. And I just thought, are they catching real terrorists here? As a British citizen who might get blown up by an Al-Qaeda nutter on a bus myself, I want the security services to catch real terrorists. I don't want them to catch dim-witted, kind of slow impressionable individuals who, if left alone, would not have the brains or anything else to carry out a proper attack. So, you know, in terms of the research that I've done, I think that terrorism is basically an industry. I think the West loves Al-Qaeda. You know, if Al-Qaeda generates so many jobs and so much money, that terrorism itself has become an industry. And, you know, as I say, I think what's happening now is that they're not really catching real terrorists. They're creating terrorists, and they're selling it to the public to justify the huge budgets that they're actually catching real Al-Qaeda. And I don't believe they are. Apart, maybe in a minority cases, they do catch some bad guys. But overall, it's a sham. So I'd like to develop one theme that was in the documentary. The documentary was an overview of what happened. There were so many things I left out, and in a way, it was quite superficial. But one theme that I'm developing personally is this targeting of young people. Because since 9/11 and 7/7, the security services have come up with this profile of a terrorist. And that is a young guy between, you know, 18 and 30, maybe with a grudge against British foreign policy. Maybe he travels to Pakistan, Somalia, or Yemen. Maybe he has downloaded, you know, Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula's Inspire magazine, English language. I mean, unbelievable amount. If you look at the terrorism convictions, a lot of them are just simply for downloading that magazine from the internet. So avoid it. I'm currently looking at universities now, because the profile of a terrorist, young guy, exposed to radical ideas, grudge against British foreign policy, you find a lot of those in British universities. So a lot of resources are going at British universities. And I'm doing a documentary on that very subject now. And the security services, from their point of view, they're looking at preemption. They're looking at finding that lone wolf who will basically, before he commits an atrocity, they want to get him. And that's, you know, Al-Qaeda as an organization is largely destroyed now in terms of its base in Afghanistan or elsewhere. So they can't really devote resources to kind of funding terrorism in these countries. So now the security services are looking at people who are self-radicalizing, lone wolf terrorists who don't have an organization to back them up. And, you know, unbelievably in many ways, they think they're going to find these guys at British universities. I don't believe they are. In terms of how this is playing out in universities, firstly, ISOCs, or Islamic societies, are under huge pressure to not talk about politics. I gave a similar talk to this a week ago in the University of Birmingham. Guess who hosted it? It wasn't the Islamic Society, it was the Black Students Association. Because the Islamic Society is, you know, scared, very scared. I was going to use a swear word then, but I won't. They're also banning so-called extremist speakers from speaking in Islamic societies. Hizb ut-Tahrir, which is a group I think most of you would be familiar with, wants an Islamic state in the Muslim world, believes in Sharia law, etc., etc. They're banned, effectively, from speaking in British universities. And so is MPAC, which is another organization which I don't know how to describe them, really. They talk a lot about Palestine, and but they're not considered radicals. They're quite mainstream within the Muslim community. Yet they're lumped in with the National Front, Combat 18, and the EDL in being on the no-platform policy of the National Union of Students. Thirdly, students are being asked to spy. I was speaking to Omar Ali, the president of FOSIS, which oversees Islamic societies in British universities, just last week, and he personally said that he'd been approached by many students who say that MI5 and police, who are all over British campuses, are effectively putting pressure on Muslim students to spy on each other. They often go for immigrants, because immigrants are vulnerable. They can be easily blackmailed, they can be deported from the country. So they'll look for some kind of leverage over you. And that may be that you are, it might be a financial inducement, it may be that you're married and you've had an affair, leverage, blackmail. It may be that you're gay. Obviously, if you're gay, you could be shunned by sections of the Muslim community because it's taboo. Maybe you've committed a crime. They'll look for some kind of leverage over you, blackmail you, and then they'll ask you to spy on other students. And often the spying will not be that guy is about to launch an attack on the West. It'll be that guy is a homosexual. You know, that literally they'll be getting tidbits of gossip and information so that the security services can put pressure on other students to spy on Muslims. And this is creating an atmosphere of paranoia amongst Muslims who are suspicious of each other when we should be giving each other the benefit of the doubt. And these spies, as you've seen in the documentary, they're not just kind of monitoring what Muslim students are doing and generally what Muslims are doing. They're trying to put words in their mouths. They're trying to get them to talk about jihad. They're trying to get them to talk about, you know, what do you want to do to these British soldiers in Afghanistan? And from the documentary, again, you can see Munir Faruqi. The police followed him for 1 year. They were recording everything he said for 1 year. Yet all they got on him was those few words. And quite frankly, if they followed me for 5 minutes, they'd get me to say more inflammatory things. But it doesn't mean you're going to do it. People say stupid things all the time, especially in an atmosphere where, you know, that's encouraged. We can say stupid things, things we don't mean. If we're pushed in a certain direction, we can say absolutely stupid stuff that has no bearing to reality. I do it all the time. You know, it doesn't mean you're going to set off a bomb. And it doesn't mean you should go down for 18 years. Fourthly, online activity, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube. It's been very, very carefully monitored by this. They're throwing billions of pounds at this kind of stuff. So just kind of concluding now, I don't want to talk too much longer. You know, I think Muslims now are living in an atmosphere where you kind of, they're about to say something dangerous or they're about to do something illegal. And, you know, we are paranoid as a community. We do shun people who are victims of infiltration themselves, like the Faruqi family. They often complain to me, not in public, but they'll complain to me that actually they've been shunned by fellow Muslims who don't want anything to do with them because they're scared. And I think Muslims are scared. And I think by and large, Muslims are taking this lying down. We're passive victims. We will be a suspect community. We will be monitored. We will be spied upon. We just have to wait for this to pass. And City University students have been very brave. They're praying outside in the streets after the university asked them to submit the sermon in advance. So they're taking a stand. But by and large, I don't think Muslims are taking a stand. I think we're passive victims. And I personally don't want to be a victim, you know. But I think that's what we are. We're victims. And I personally feel quite dirty being a victim. So I think ultimately we have to organise ourselves, which is incredibly difficult because we're so divided on sectarian lines and nationalistic lines. And especially with the Arab Spring now, it's exacerbating differences in our community, which is already divided. And it's just a tragedy. But from my perspective, I just think the first step is to make Muslims aware of what is happening. There is nothing particularly new about what I put in my documentary. But the fact is that hardly anyone is talking about it. You know, and mainstream Muslim organizations don't want anything to do with it. And, you know, I have not got a platform to speak on, even though ordinary Muslims have been coming to me in droves. And probably what I've done with this has generated more talk than a lot of the other things I've ever done in my career. Mainstream Muslim organizations have shunned it, by and large. They don't want to touch it because it's too controversial. And obviously, they want to stay in with government and the establishment. And it's made me lose faith in our leaders, quite frankly. And our leaders, by the way, are being targeted. We shouldn't be naive about that. The MI5 targets Muslim leaders. Again, I don't want to point fingers or whatever, but we shouldn't be naive about what's happening. Leaders have a flock. And because they have that flock, people follow them, they are natural targets for MI5, as are women. It's amazing how many women's groups the government funds, because women are considered more moderate than men. Also, they're bringing up the young terrorists who are going to set off bombs. They're targeting the Somali community in particular. Maybe that can come out in the Q&A. And they're targeting young people, as I've already mentioned. And the government has this very narrow idea of what Islamism is. You know, they consider Islamism a slippery slope to bombing, basically, and extremism, when it isn't. It's a sophisticated ideology which is mainstream in the Muslim world, and to caricature it like that is really, really poor. Just literally one last point, and that is that ultimately this, you know, 80% of this, this might seem trite, but 80% of this actually does come down to foreign policy, I think. If you get rid of that issue, there is absolutely no excuse for al-Qaeda or anyone else to bomb the West. This is the cause of radicalization in this country, by and large. There are other exacerbating factors. There is extremism being promoted from abroad. There is extremism within our community. But the fact is, if you take the foreign policy factor away, then there's nothing to bite on. There's absolutely no excuse for these radical groups to attack trains and buses in Britain. And finally, I would say that as a British citizen, I've said this before, I could be blown up on a bus by an al-Qaeda member. And therefore, I want the security services, I acknowledge they have a right to go after terrorists, but go after real terrorists. Don't cast your net so wide that you're effectively going after the whole Muslim community. Okay.
Thank you very much. I'd like to open the floor to questions. You don't have to be scared here. Okay, yes, please.
Well, thank you very much for the enlightening documentary. I did learn quite a bit that I did not know before I came here. And I think those were a lot of very good points, and it has changed my perspective on some things. There was one thing that slightly struck a nerve, so I'm going to phrase this as a question, although we all know it's really a comment. As a white American Muslim, I have frequently been the suspicion of accusations of spying and working for this organization and that in the Muslim community. Sometimes very vociferous accusations, which are completely unfounded, I might add. And I have to say, when the lady in the film said that she couldn't trust her husband anymore, that definitely also struck a nerve too. And I have to say, in general, I mean, I'm from America, if you can't tell, there was one case of someone pretending to convert to Islam and trying to get people riled up about jihad, and then they turned him into the government.
Craig
but,
Martell, yeah. In
yeah,
Orange
but
County,
it,
yeah.
In general, as far as I know, it is usually not people who pose as converts, from my background at least, who have been thought to or have been found to or have been seen to work for the government, and it kind of makes more sense to have someone who looks like everyone else and who can blend in rather than someone who looks obviously different and people might be suspicious of. So I guess I'm saying, to get to the question part, I mean, where is the line? You mentioned it's good to be suspicious of some people, and definitely if someone seems to be sort of trying to entrap people, I would be suspicious no matter what their ethnicity is, but it also tears our community apart to be casting suspicion on people just because they're white or black or whatever. So how do you balance all of those concerns?
I mean, I'm glad you said what you said, because I don't know where you draw the line. It's a very difficult question, and I acknowledge everything that you said. I'm not trying to say that converts should be held under suspicion, although I have been accused of saying that by many people. That's why I think this tactic of using converts, and it is happening, is such a disgusting tactic, because it tears communities apart, it puts suspicions on people who are completely innocent. And I think what I said before is the best answer I can give, and that is that if someone converts to Islam, and literally the next day they are asking you about British troops in Afghanistan, what you'd like, you know, let's go and do something, or trying to put words into your mouth, and they're literally more interested in that than they are about asking you about Allah and the Quran and the Hadith, then I just think we have a right to be suspicious, given what we know is happening. But I do acknowledge all your concerns, and and that's the best answer I can give, and I know it's not the best answer. Maybe it's not the answer you wanted to hear.
Everyone's entitled to their own.
Yeah.
I think there were two hands at the back there as well.
Assalamu alaikum. First of all, jazakallah khair for your documentary. It was very enlightening. My question was this. As you mentioned that your next project is going to be more to do with universities and so forth, the recent events at City University are a prime example of how the government are striking fear to ensure that students don't become politicized and they don't ask the tough questions. And we all know most students go through that phase at university, and to get them depoliticized, that's the exact way you would go about it. At the same time, you have pro-Zionist groups on campus that go through the JSOCs, and they have organizations like Aish Malak who actually recruit for the IDF right here on our British campuses. It's been well documented that they do it, and yet they're given carte blanche and the government will do absolutely nothing to stop them. And yet when a Muslim just simply wants to have their right to pray, it's a big issue. Now there's got to be a balance drawn between the two, and if you don't, then it smacks of hypocrisy.
Yeah, I mean, what I would say is that universities should be places where you talk about radical ideas and you get that out of your system and you think it through. So to curtail freedom of speech in universities is absolutely ridiculous. And also what is happening, because Muslim students don't want to talk about politics in universities, is that it's being pushed into the margins. It's being pushed underground, and that potentially is quite dangerous. If you don't give the mainstream a forum, then you are going to radicalize people, and you can monitor what's going on in universities. You can't necessarily monitor what's happening in street corners. And the second thing, I have been hearing that there is a lot of Islamophobia being promoted by different societies on campuses. I have heard that JSOCs have been doing it, but I don't want to generalize because I know there are JSOCs that definitely don't indulge in that. There are atheist societies at Reading University, for example. There was an incredible case where they at the Freshers' Fair, they had some kind of caricature of the Prophet Muhammad. I think it was something, it was an orange with the Prophet Muhammad's face on it, or something, disgusting like that, so offensive. It seems that kind of behavior is not being cracked down upon, but any kind of political rumblings from Islamic societies is. And City University, I was there for the Jummah last week, and they've said to, the university, if you want to know what we're saying, come to our prayer, but we're not going to give you the khutbah in advance. And I personally think that's quite a reasonable position.
Assalamu alaikum. Two questions, one serious and one little bit lighter. The serious bit is, what is the going rate for joining the MI5?
What is the what, sorry?
The going rate.
I don't know. Would you happen? Approach me.
Because it's something that I have been trying to find out for the past 4 years. The simple the reason being that the MI5 budget used to be 50 million in 2007. Last year it ballooned to 475 million. So you can imagine how much money we are spending in all this unnecessary crap. So I'm thinking to myself, if everybody is having a free lunch, dinner and breakfast throughout the night, why not join? So I started finding out what is the going rate, but nobody has been able to tell me. On the lighter note, the systems that we tend to be under, there's a lot of, my English is not very good, what's that word? Radicalization at the grassroots levels from the schoolings, in the year 5, year 7 schools, year 9 schools, when kids start throwing stones at each other in each other's houses, that is when this MI5 start to, track down the families. I know a couple of families who have been tracked down for the past, I think, 4 years, for no apparent reason, just because their sons in year 8 and year 9 were having a lot of these, Yankee American do-good action hero conversations, which happened to just be recorded by some teacher or somehow. And there is this whole net that has been, done in London, in Northwest London, that money keeps on being spent by the MI5s and nobody seems to be accountable. And it seems nobody is accountable because whenever complaints have been done to the MPs or the police don't want to know. The Houses of Parliament MPs or the local councillors, it seems everybody keeps on fobbing each other off as to what's happening. But everything, you are being followed, you are being watched, you are being taped, you are being, seen, looked, bank accounts followed, everything. But it seems nobody in this country is accountable when MI5 is involved.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think MI5 is not an accountable organization. You can't sue MI5 in an open court. If an MI5 agent ever does appear in a court, it's always behind a screen. I attended a control order hearing one where an MI5 agent gave evidence from behind a screen, and he kept on saying, I'm not at liberty to discuss that. And, you know, basically, I mean, a barrister friend of mine who's dealt with MI5 and cases like this, he describes MI5 as a criminal organization with a license to commit crime. You know, they can do whatever they want, basically. And you know, you can't really catch them. In terms of schools, I mean, I've heard anecdotal evidence, and actually not anecdotal, factual evidence, that they're actually targeting schools as young as nursery schools. You know, it's just, you know, I don't know. You know, it's incredible the kind of stuff they're doing. And in terms of, you know, often there'll be informal visits to suspect families or whatever. And they won't have anything on these families. They might just have the flimsiest of suspicion. But they'll go around and they'll turn up and they'll, you know, try and have informal conversations. But there'll be prevent officers doing that, which can be quite intimidating. And I think there's a term called gaslighting, which is a form of psychological warfare. And that's what's going on, I think. You know, just by turning up and turning up in uniform or whatever, it puts pressure on people. And, you know, it immediately, they will feel inhibited, and maybe they won't talk about the politics they want to talk about, and it spreads fear without actually, you know, having any evidence against anybody, without any crime taking place. I think the intention is to spread fear amongst the community so that they will self-censor, and they won't be organized, they'll be divided, and I think that's a deliberate tactic, even if it's an unofficial tactic.
Before taking a couple more questions here and there, I just wanted to draw together a couple of things that came up here and see if you can maybe talk a little bit about your ideas of the community response, because as you said, I think a lot of us here, and the prisoners are here, IHRC as well, we've had this experience that I guess we're not the mainstream Muslim organisations, but it's very hard to get a kind of consistent community-wide action.
Yeah.
What we have here is the sister mentioned about suspicion, right?
Mm.
And us becoming suspicious of each other. You mentioned it's not just converts at university, you've got immigrants, you've got people who may have, you know, personal issues that it could be used to exploit them. And then you've got this, as you said, this prevalence of fear, really. I mean, we know that certain people are targeted and there's a certain type, but then the community itself gets very paranoid, it self-censors, and it has a lot of issues that way. So what do you see, having, you know, been dealing with this for 10 plus years, as a way forward for community leadership?
I mean, I don't have all the answers, and I'm not going to kid you that I, you know, I'm not here to give you an inspirational talk about how we're going to get stronger and stronger and we're going to beat the bad guys. You know, I'm nearly 40 years old now, and I've been following the Muslim community for 20 years. And even though we have a lot more halal meat shops and a lot more madrasas and a lot more mosques, have we actually made advances as a community? I'm not so sure if we have. So I'm not here to paint a rosy picture of the future. I think we've got some serious thinking to do. I think we're going through a very difficult moment where the community, because of what's happening abroad and in the Arab world especially, the community is at risk of dividing on sectarian lines especially. And I think we all have to, anyone with a brain has got to realize, despite what's happening in Syria or elsewhere, that these are temporary political events. But they will end at some point. And we've got to make sure that we are not destroyed as a community while those events are playing out, while that madness, quite frankly, is playing out. And I can't emphasize that enough. Because as long as we're divided, it seems very simple, but it's true. As long as we're divided, we have no chance whatsoever. And what is going on at the moment is that we have Muslim leaders in our community and their foot soldiers who are playing an active role in destroying the Muslim community. I know that sounds very strong, but it's true. This is what is happening at the moment. And I have strong views about political events in the Arab world and beyond, but we're all at fault, and we're seeing our community destroying itself, and we have to be very, very vigilant, and we've got to look at the big picture, and we've got to look at the long term, and we've got to think with our brains and not with our emotions. And that's probably the most important thing that I've said tonight.
I'm going to take two questions together, and then we can deal with those, and then we have one from online, which is a very important contribution. I want to go
Thank you. You alluded to the foreign policy aspect, but all we hear is, you know, these people want to take away our freedoms and they don't like our way of life. So, I mean, are the government actually...
Muslims?
No, by the media, for example, or by, you know, even by the government.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so it seems the government's actually being very dishonest by pushing that and not actually mentioning the foreign policy factor at all. But what about groups like the Killian Foundation? How much are they actually contributing to this kind of disproportionate blanketing of targeting Muslims?
Well, I think there's no doubt that the government and the right-wing press, they want to minimize the role of foreign policy when, in fact, it is the major factor. I mean, some people will have different statistics. Some people will say it's 80% foreign policy and 20% extremism from within the Muslim community itself, which does exist. And I think that's about right. But it's clear from the government, if you look at the government's prevent policy, which is available on the Home Office website, when they refer to foreign policy grievances, they'll say perceived foreign policy grievances. And it's hardly mentioned in their prevent strategy at all, when that should be their main focus. If they really want to get rid of extremism, if they really want to stop bombs going off, then that should be their main focus, not a kind of a side issue. Quillian Foundation, I mean, they have lost their funding as of a year ago. They're keeping going somehow. They're not as effective as they used to be, but they still do get a disproportionate platform. And I have an objection to, I mean, I don't mind grassroots organizations forming. Like, for example, the Salafis in this country, the Shia, the Ikhwanis, they have serious grassroots constituencies. And they represent a lot of people, whereas Quillian Foundation only exists because of government finances. And they don't represent anybody, yet they have a disproportionate voice. And they have been, obviously some of what they say is true, but it's obviously, you know, like Hitler told half-truths as well, didn't he, you know? They have had a major role in promoting Islamophobia in this country. Because where are they published? They're always published in The Sun or the Daily Mail. Who's cheering them on? Douglas Murray, you know, the Center for Social Cohesion. The Henry Jackson Society. These are the people that love what Majid Nawaz is saying and what Ed Hussein used to say. Whereas, you know, even though there is some truth in what they say, it's the platforms that they're using, the way they frame the argument, that has been a major, major promoter of Islamophobia in this country over the last 5 years.
Assalamu alaikum. Jazakallah for your documentary. Just to add to this, you're going down the route of investigating universities and the passiveness as well of the community. One thing which I want to add to that, just as a comment really, as somebody working in academia and Islamic studies, which is the other side, which is the lecturer or the teacher side and the control of knowledge, which I think why the community or students are passive, is how Islamic studies is taught and experience and practice, even within Muslim madrasas, even within Muslim colleges, is you teach basically medieval history. So you streamline Islamic studies and you make sure that you're just teaching the Prophet as a historical figure. You'll teach Ghazali, you'll teach conflicts in Hadith. So students come out thinking that this is what I have to know about Islam, and this is why there is a passive response. The minute that you go into the politics and things, one, you won't get hired. The people that do get hired are people that go into mundane aspects of Islamic history and they'll get paid £40,000 to £60,000 or whatever it is. The third thing, which I think is a problem, is, as you hinted at, is the lack of courage by the Muslim community. Our TV channels are poor because they just give lots of majalis, for example. Our own leaders don't like to talk about politics on the minbar. So what's happening is our own Muslim system of knowledge is so historical and so out of touch that we don't even have the intellectual tools to respond. And what's more than that is, if even if I'm not going to do Islamic studies and I'm going to go to university, and I'm going, and now Islamic studies modules are very common, so even non-Muslim students will learn about Islam. You'll take that module, you'll get the 70% or 60%, but at the end of the day, you'll end up as a basically passive person. So I myself am interested in this and have had my own experiences, but I'm just adding to that because I think it's a very interesting direction that you're taking, and it's just I wanted to give another side.
I mean, I think in university, I think a lot of university lecturers are very unhappy about being asked to monitor and spy on their Muslim students. And I've met one who actually lost his job because he took a stand in support of a guy called Rizwan Sabir in Nottingham. So, you know, we shouldn't underestimate the fact that universities are very uneasy. Some go full hog with the prevent strategy and implement to the letter what the government is asking them to do, and the security services, they let the police and MI5 in. Others show real resistance at cost to themselves, especially individual lecturers. I mean, the other point I would make is, I think, you know, I wouldn't say this in a room full of non-Muslims, but because this is majority Muslim, I think this is the right platform to say this. I think we as a community have to stop being victims. And we have to look inside, look in the mirror, and realize that, you know, people who don't like us will do what they do. But ultimately, our destiny is in our own hands. And if we organize, if we become better, then we won't have anything to worry about. I mean, if you look at, in my own field, media, for example, I mean, the Jewish community is, what, 300,000 people in this country or something like that, whereas Muslims are 2.5 million or more. The Jewish Chronicle has existed for 100 years. You know, a very professional community newspaper. What have we got? You know, we have got, you know, publications now and TV channels, but they're all of very average quality. Our business ethics as a community is very poor. We don't turn up on time. You know, we don't treat our staff like we should be treating them. And quite frankly, if you go into a non-Muslim organization, they treat their staff better. Their management practices are better. They're more Islamic in the way they treat their staff than Muslims are. And again, we have to realize this, and we've got to pull our socks up, you know?
I have a question here that's come online. I think you've covered some of it already, but it's important that I read it out because it's come from the Save the Family Home campaign, which is Munir Farooqi's family campaign. I'm really glad that they've joined in with this, as their case was just so, and still is so, appalling. They say, thank you very much for organising the event, and their question to you is that you say yourself that not many people have offered to even screen the documentary, even though it is perfectly legal. Why is it that so many leaders, institutions, Muslim groups refuse to talk about this issue when it dramatically affects our community at large? If it is just fear, what do you think we can do in our communities to override this fear? And they end with a request, and I reiterate it, that could everybody please, whoever's watching, whoever's here, visit their website, www.savethefamilyhome.com, and sign both their petitions about their case online. And I'll repeat that at the end, and we will put a link to it online as well. I don't know if there's anything else you want to touch upon.
Well, I mean, I think it needs to be said, why are Muslim institutions, it's not just this documentary, but why are they so, you know, kind of rubbish, you know? There's a reason for that. They're in bed with the establishment. They want to rock the boat. That's why they're so rubbish. And they're failing us, quite frankly. They're completely failing us. They're not representing us. You know, they're getting their knighthoods. And they might do some good, but, you know, quite frankly, a monkey could do some good if they had loads of money supporting them and backing them up. You know, our leaders are failing us, and they have been for a long time, and they're far too close to the establishment. They're far too, desirous of knighthoods and the perks that high status brings. And I just think it's disgusting. That's my opinion.
Question from you. Over here.
I will never get a job in the mainstream Muslim organization with an attitude like that.
Neither most of us.
I was curious to know whether you experienced any harassment while you were making the film.
Yeah. Well, no, I didn't. I approached MI5. I approached I mean, I went outside their building, you know, and immediately the police officers came up and they were very polite, but, you know, go away was the message, basically.
No, I have never been approached by MI5, which makes me think I'm not doing something right. You know, why haven't they, you know, I mean, personally, with my contacts in the Muslim community, I think I'm an obvious person to approach. And who knows if the price is right? Do you know what I mean? No. But you know.
You heard it here first. Don't anyone say you didn't know.
But yeah, I've never been approached, ever. And I think now, because I'm so public in what I do, I think they know that if they approach me, it'll backfire because I'll put it straight on Facebook. You know, and they know what I do. And so I don't think there's any sense in them approaching me now. But certainly in the early years of my career, when I wasn't so public, then I think I would have been the ideal MI5 agent. But they haven't approached me. I don't think they will. But I obviously have talked to tens and dozens and hundreds of people who have been approached.
I was thinking more in terms of when you started to make it, when you were making the film.
Yes.
Whether there was, you didn't have any restrictions or you didn't find it difficult to access people?
Well, in terms of accessing the government institutions, yeah, very, complete brick wall. Police wouldn't talk to me. The minister responsible wouldn't talk to me. No official reaction whatsoever, fobbing off completely. And I think, personally, that's going to backfire because a lot of people are interested in what I'm doing. And I'm getting a lot of feedback and doing a lot of talk. So if they want to do that, that's fine. No skin off my nose. I gave them the opportunity. They flunked it.
Okay, so the last round of questions from the floor. One, two. Did I see another hand at the back there? Three. Anybody else? If I can take them all in one go, and then you can address them how you feel.
Okay. Assalamu alaikum. Thank you very much for showing us this documentary. What I'd like to first say is I think you shouldn't give up and just try and just contact, send letters, emails to the larger mosques because they got larger numbers, so you'll get more people seeing this if they allow you in. But the question I have is, how do we get the mosques to start caring, or even the attendees? Because in one tribe and community during the Gaza War, say 2009, some brothers and sisters were put in jail for minor offences, maybe saying a rude word to the police, throwing a bottle, and everybody else from their tribe, and their tribes could have thousands of members, all affluent as well, so they could have done some sort of leveraging or solicitors. Everyone just ignored it. Let the people go to jail, so those people's families' lives are wrecked. You've had times when similar tribes have a member killed. The people who, like a grandfather would be killed. The people who do the murder only get 12 and 18 months in jail. Whereas the guys who say bad, the guys who just say their view on Facebook get like 10 years, 5 years. Again, community is just silent. In fact, their response is inviting police and MPs down for a cup of tea, trying to get people to vote Labour or vote Tory. So what do we have to do? Or what should we be pressuring leaders to do or trying to make the members who fund these communities or attend these communities, how do we enlighten them so they can start backing each other up?
I'm not sure how to answer that. As I said, I don't have all the answers, but I think that without doubt, we shouldn't... I'm not going to advocate insurrection against Muslim leaders or mosques. I think that would completely backfire. And I don't believe in it. You know, it's that is not part of the Islamic akhlaq, you know, the moral code that we follow. But at the same time, I do think our leaders have failed us over many years. I do think they're out of touch with the youth. I do think they've got too many vested interests. What can you do apart from keep knocking on the door and trying to persuade them and create our own institutions? You know, I think we are, you know, a new generation is taking over. I'm not sure if they're any better than the leaders, to be honest. You know, the leaders, the old guard had their faults, but they had their advantages as well. I'm not here to say that the younger generation is any better, quite frankly. Maybe they're worse, but in different ways. Sorry, I'm depressing you all, aren't I? But as I say, it's not a rosy picture. And I'm not here
to give you some kind of you know, BS inspirational talk, you know, like an evangelical preacher. I'm here to describe the reality as I see it, working with the Muslim communities at home and abroad for about 20 years. It's not a pretty picture.
How would you explain, or what do you think about the differences directed towards, like the Irish community, or the real IRA, for example, or right wing nutters who, for example, have equipment and tools, and they get lesser sentences than Muslims who may have just express an interest or something that could get them.
I think Northern Irish terrorism is actually a greater threat than Al Qaeda inspired terrorism. And I know that a bomb was found in a car and in County Fermanagh, I think, last week. And just imagine if it was a Muslim with a bomb in his boot. You know, it'll be all over the press, and everyone will be like, you know, jumping through hoops and making a big hoo-ha about it. But yeah, I mean, I've had the dubious pleasure of reading the Prevent Strategy, really boring, but it does mention Northern Irish terrorism and white extremism as well as threats, but obviously the major focus is on the Muslim community, and I do think they've got the proportions wrong there. And but yeah, as you know, just imagine, you know, the kind of stuff that is coming out of Northern Ireland on a weekly basis: bombs in house, weapons caches. You know, just imagine if it was a Muslim that was caught in possession of those.
What explains the difference in terms of sentences?
Well, what do you think? You know, white people, brown people.
There's
latent racism in there, I'm sure, going back many generations, all of it. They don't call it racism anymore. But yeah, Islamophobia is the new racism, right? You know, where the Muslim community is an easier target. And ultimately, where is the money for the security services, for the media commentator? It's in Al-Qaeda-inspired terrorism. It's not in going on TV and talking about the Troubles. Yeah.
Just before we go to the question, we can comment on more pessimism, I guess.
Yeah.
Although it doesn't directly say so, from the app on Twitter, it says it's a struggle politically for our human rights as decreed by your mind. They're bearing heads in the sand, so his message is to everyone get active.
Yes, thank you for the documentary. Bearing in mind your observations on the shortcomings of some of the leaders and etc., and also the fear amongst your compatriots, is there any practical advice you could give to a Muslim that was being blackmailed? Mm. Who would he actually turn to?
Well, I think having spoken to a few lawyers about this, what they say is, you know, if a Prevent officer or an MI5 officer turns up at your front door, you should not get into informal conversations with them, because they're much more skilled than you are. They can get you to incriminate yourself despite the fact that you might be completely innocent. They can twist your words, and they can get you to say stuff that you don't want to say. You should refuse to speak to them without a lawyer. You shouldn't refuse to speak to them full stop, but say, I will speak to you, but in the presence of a lawyer. So you should know your rights, don't get involved in these informal situations where they approach you in the street or whatever. The shutter should go up immediately. I'll speak to you, but I'll speak to you with my legal representative.
They're passionate about students and have a reach of the entire country, and they can get ISOCs involved, and they care. Is this a strategy you think we should be going with the mainstream organisations?
Well, I met Omar Ali from FOSIS last week. I've never met him before. I always had this impression of FOSIS being quite... quite an ineffective organisation, in bed with the establishment... From articles that I'd read over many years. But I must admit, when I met him, he was pressing all the right buttons. And he was saying, look, this spying is going on, this infiltration is going on. And he was much more radical than I am now, you know. So that shocked me a bit and quite impressed me. But I don't know A to Z, the history of FOSIS, so I don't want to talk too much. All I can say is that
you know, ultimately, if you're in charge of an organization like that, you know, you do have to liaise with people who are in authority, and you can't speak as freely as I'm speaking now. But given that, I thought, you know, Omar Ali and Fosis were saying the right kind of stuff and were reflecting the anxieties of ordinary Muslim students.
Okay, so we have a question, even though I said we won't have any more from the floor, but seeing as it's the chair of HRC, I guess I better give him the mic.
First of all, I'm really disappointed. Does that mean that I will not get a knighthood now? Only if I knew. You know, I think the point that I like to make is, you know, this issue that we should not be silent victims. You know, we are victims. We should recognize we are victims,
yeah,
and actually build upon that. And I would like to actually, for all those who are watching and those who are here and talk to your friends and everything, one thing is a key thing that if you're approached, yes, get a lawyer. If you cannot get a lawyer, don't keep silent about it. Don't keep it to yourself, because that's what, you know, security forces thrive on. You really need to let as many people know. Contact organization like ours, you know, we have an advocacy department. We could put you in touch with lawyers and so forth. We could actually make it public, so they realize that they cannot sort of make you a victim and thrive on your innocence and actually put fear. One thing. And the second thing is that, you know, we're talking about the leadership. I think, unfortunately, we have got managers of the community rather than leaders, because leaders will have visions and move forward.
Mm-hmm.
And but in absence of that, I think what we need to do is, there are a number of organizations which have actually have taken up on this, you know, including ourselves, CAGE, and a few others. And I think really it's coming to the point that those of us in that arena, we need to get together and have some sort of positive projects to actually move forward on these. And my last thing is that they put this level of sort of harassment against you, because they're trying to give the signal that if you are political, if you are in standing for justice, be it in Kashmir, be it in Palestine and so forth, you are going to be facing and pay the consequences. You're going to be put under pressure, you're going to be demonized, etc. And by that process, they want to make sure as little as most people will not get involved in this sort of thing and become just totally zombies, you know, going around. And I think that's part of the policy. But I think it's very important that don't be a silent victim, you know, getting in touch with people like us, CAGE and others, and we will make sure that it will not be isolated.
Can I just quickly add to that? Yeah, I mean, but the reality is, it is really difficult to get different members of the Muslim community representing different traditions in the same room without there being a big fight. And I've experienced this myself in a few forums. And I think it's really incumbent on the leaders of Salafis, Shia, Sufis, whatever, to put aside the small things which divide them and concentrate on the big things that unite them. At the moment, and I blame the leaders, because the foot soldiers will follow the leaders. They're the emotional ones. The leaders know what's going on. They know what's happening, and they know the result of their words or their silence. Yet they are letting what's going on now in the Muslim community happen. They're letting it happen, and the community is destroying itself. They need to grow up and accept responsibility, because they might be the generation that destroyed the Muslim community, not just in the UK and abroad. And they may be remembered, you know, as that in years to come. And I know that there are two leaders here, you know, with influence over, you know, perhaps different sections of the community, who I hope can travel in that direction.
I think you may have accidentally been inspirational. If you have any further words to add?
No, I don't. You know, as Masood said, let's stop being victims. We are victims, but I don't like being a victim. I don't want to be a victim. I want to be in the driving seat. I want to be the guy that, you know, is a control freak and everyone's listening to me and doing what I say. I mean, you know, I'm exaggerating. But I don't want to be the guy that's going around complaining, oh, Muslims are being targeted, where, you know, this is happening to us, boo-hoo-hoo, you know? I've given that same speech and I've done that same report a million times. So, you know, I don't want to be a victim anymore.
Well, with that, let's wrap up for the evening. Thank you very much. And it has been a pleasure, albeit a slightly depressing one. But I think you've given us plenty to think about and plenty to actually unpack if we are actually going to move forward. Those of you following this online and on Twitter, please keep the conversation going. I think it's just started picking up as we were coming to the end of that. Just a reminder, you know, please do go to savethefamilyhome.com. Which is the campaign for Munir Faruqi's family, and sign the online petitions there. And don't forget to maybe contribute to some of the organisations like ourselves and like Cage Prisoners. So I'm just going to plug our link, shop.ihrc.org, and I think is it cageprisoners.com? Yeah, and cageprisoners.com. And think about helping us trying to move forward some more.